The Subcommittee on Water and Power will come to order. I apologize to all for the late start. The good news is we won't be interrupted by votes from here. Quorum is present, and we'll begin with opening statements. Today, the subcommittee meets for the purpose of a hearing on power marketing administrations from the ratepayers' perspective. We're going to hear from ratepayers who are bearing spiraling costs for electricity caused by ill-advised government policy. These are the ratepayers who bought and paid for the great hydropower projects of the 20th century, but who are today facing rapidly escalating surcharges and hidden costs to indulge policies imposed upon them by the federal government for programs that they do not want and benefits they do not receive. Earlier this year, this subcommittee heard from the administrators of the power marketing administrations of their plans for the coming fiscal year. Yet they aren't the ones paying the bills. They are the ones imposing them under federal law. This hearing today will focus on those who actually pay the electricity bills and who must answer to their customers, the families and businesses that actually write the checks to their local utility each month. These families and businesses deserve to know why their electricity bills are skyrocketing, and the answer is very simple: government policy emanating from this administration. And that's the fine point of the matter. Wise public policy produced the era of hydroelectric dams that today produce the cleanest and cheapest electricity on the planet, ultimately paid by the users of that electricity and not by general taxpayers. These projects also made possible the environmental benefits of year-round water flows in dry times and flood control after deluges. They provided the water necessary for the greening of the West and vast new recreational resources enjoyed by untold thousands of Americans. But these great hydroelectric projects are ideologically displeasing to the political left, which has been amazingly successful, first at discouraging the construction of new projects, and are now encouraging the destruction of existing ones. The left has sought to impose draconian restrictions on water usage while asserting that's the same as increasing the supply. They've imposed outrageously expensive technologies and hidden the costs of these mandates by shifting them to consumers represented by the groups before us today, as well as to the general taxpayers who are supposed to be represented by each of us on this dais. The cheap and abundant water and power created by these projects made possible the explosive growth and prosperity of the Western United States. As we shall hear, the war now waged against these projects has imposed prohibitive costs that are now destroying that prosperity. Yet while dramatically restricting these projects and vastly inflating their costs, the left tells us that we must mandate electric trains and cars at a time when we can't guarantee enough electricity to keep people's refrigerators running this summer. We will hear testimony today that hydropower from federal dams continues to be a base resource that is cheaper than any other form of electricity available to us. Families and businesses have paid for this resource with interest under the long-standing beneficiary pays principle. The premise of this doctrine is that those who benefit should pay for their commensurate costs. That doctrine is being radically transformed under this administration that seems intent on imposing costly mandates, regulations, fees, and litigation that are making the monthly arrival of the family utility bill a growing financial nightmare. For example, we'll hear that Central Valley Project power customers are being fleeced by an unaccountable tax program that lavishes funds on environmental causes while inflating electricity prices to cost prohibitive levels. We will also hear more of former Energy Secretary Stephen Chu's far-reaching 2012 memorandum that would use ratepayers as a piggy bank for the pet projects of the left, projects that offer no benefits to these consumers but impose back-breaking new costs. This radical policy, initially drafted in secrecy with no consultation with the consumers directly affected by it, sought to subsidize wildly expensive and intermittent wind and solar energies and to hide their true costs from the public. There are many questions and not enough answers as to how the current version of this document will be implemented. Common sense should tell us that a government that confuses rationing with abundance, or that mistakes ideological sophistry for sound resource management, will condemn itself to increasingly painful shortages and economic distress. Once again, it comes down to two very different visions of the future. One is a dark and dismal time when families will be forced to painfully stretch and ration every drop of water and every watt of electricity in their sweltering and dimly lit homes. The other is a new era of abundance where vast sources of clean and inexpensive water and power restore the prosperity that Americans once knew until it was foolishly thrown away on the altar of the radical environmental left. That I recognize the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good afternoon to the witnesses. Thank you for being with us today. And I have read the testimony, and I do have a few questions. And Mr. Chairman, we talk about sticking to the old way of doing things, which is in many ways is helpful, but sometimes we need to understand there's many challenges we've got to face and work together on. Today's hearing does focus on the ratepayer perspective of our four power marketing administrations, our PMAs, yet even with each of them, there is diversity within the customer base. And it can be easily seen with our witnesses today from WAPA, representing geographically diverse regions of the Western Service Area from CVP, Central Valley Project, to the Tohono O'odham Tribal Utility. And finally, the Big Sloan and the Colorado River Storage Projects. Each of them faces its own set of new and old challenges, and each has differences in its underlying authority. Despite all these differences, there are some commonalities. All of the testimony today recognize the PMA's core mission of providing cost-based power to preference customers. This is implicit to the PMAs, but just as inherent is the ability of each one of them to meet the core mission in light of the changing environment. And I'm using that term generally, environment meaning all of it. Our changing times, our weather changes, our economic changes, everything. These include the impacts of climate change on snowpack and subsequent hydropower production. Also include the operation and management and repair of facilities that are at or reaching their design life, if not already past their design life, and integrating renewable, the commonly known green energy, as part of our power supply. But any solution to these challenges must first and foremost involve active communication by the PMAs to ratepayers and stakeholders. But by the same token, ratepayers also have a responsibility to assess these ideas in a productive manner. Our testimony today also reflects the many progressive actions being undertaken by the ratepayers. And this, of course, includes conservation, energy initiative, and energy efficient initiatives, as well as renewable energy development by the Snohomish Public Utility District in Washington State. The Tohono O'odham Nation will talk about the development of a solar farm that will eventually utilize a transmission infrastructure program, funded transmission line called the ED5 Palo Verde Project. Testimony from Bonneville ratepayers also highlights the region's integration of 4,500 megawatts of wind power into its system, as well as the challenges of an integrated wind. Now, for many years, we talked about developing new power. When we first started about developing green power energy, whether it was solar or the windmill, there were a lot of questions at the time about the ability for it to function properly economically and where would it be sited. Well, we've grown, and we will continue to grow, and we need to be open to those growth challenges that we all will be facing in the future, because Mother Nature is throwing many curves at us, and we need to be prepared for what will be coming down the pike. So I thank all of you. In order to accomplish these goals, we must meet those challenges and continue to meet the Power Marketing Administration's unique missions. There must be active communication between the PMAs, the ratepayers, stakeholders, and don't forget us here, so that we know how we can help being able to continue your goal in helping you in your mission. Thank you. Look forward to hearing from our witnesses. I yield back the balance of my time.
Chair is pleased to note the presence of the chairman of the House Natural Resources Committee, Congressman Doc Hastings of Washington, and pleased to recognize him for 5 minutes.
Good. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you again for the courtesy of allowing me to make a statement. This hearing provides an opportunity to fill one of the primary responsibilities of this committee, which is to exercise oversight over the agencies within our jurisdiction. As witnessed by the actions of the Department of Energy over the last 2 years, the Power Marketing Administrations, particularly the Western Area Power Administration, or WAPA, are ripe for continued oversight. While ratepayers typically recover all of the costs of these agencies, Congress must do its part to ensure that their electricity rates remain fair and at the lowest possible costs within sound business practices. And that's what this hearing is about. Hearing from those who actually pay the bills provides a forum for this committee to assess what's working and what's not for these agencies. For generations, the PMAs, including the Bonneville Power Administration and my home region of the Pacific Northwest, have provided low-cost, affordable, and renewable electricity to millions of consumers. Grand Coulee Dam in my congressional district is a flagship of this successful story. To this day, it is the largest electricity provider in the nation and captures enough water to irrigate almost 700,000 acres of what I think is the best agriculture area land in the world. And I say that knowing I have Californians on this committee. BPA relies largely on hydropower dams to provide the cleanest, most efficient forms of renewable energy. And it's one that makes possible other forms of energy that are intermittent in nature, like wind. But times are changing in the West, thanks to never-ending lawsuits by litigious groups, activist judges, and a Washington, D.C. knows best attitude. In fact, just last week, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC, rejected a regional approach for transmission planning and cost allocation that has worked well for years in the Pacific Northwest. Down the street at the Forestall Building, the Department of Energy continues to push to implement its top-down CHU memo and other federal government-inspired idea called access to capital. Time and again, the customers who pay these bills are left wondering whether these are simply solutions in search of problems. It seems to me that one of the reasons the PMAs have worked so well is because they have enjoyed well-established partnerships with their customers. What a novel idea. As we will hear today, these partnerships have eroded over the last 2 years. The PMAs and DOE can do better, and we are going to continue asking questions and to provide oversight in that area. And at this time, Mr. Chairman, I see one of your first witnesses is Mr. Scott Corin of the Public Power Council. He is a frequent witness to this committee. He represents many consumer-owned utilities that rely on the hydropower that I mentioned earlier in the Northwest. And he has provided valuable insight in the past with his testimony. So I look forward to his testimony here again and welcome Mr. Corin to the committee. And I yield back my time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. If there are no further opening statements, what a great transition to our panel of witnesses. I'd ask that witnesses keep their statements to 5 minutes. That's outlined in our invitation letter. And also, I want to explain how the timing lights work. They're carefully calibrated to the attention span of an average member of Congress, which means the green light, you've got our undivided attention. At yellow, attention is beginning to wane, and when the red light goes on, we've stopped listening, so you might as well stop talking. If it's any consolation, members are subject to the same time limit. And with that, I'm pleased to welcome back Mr. Scott Corwin to the subcommittee. He's the Executive Director of the Public Power Council in Portland, Oregon, for 5 minutes.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ranking Member. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your kind comments, members of the committee. Pleased to be here today. Again, I'm Scott Corwin. I represent consumer-owned electric utilities in the Northwest that buy power and transmission from the Bonneville Power Administration, or BPA. Our members are utilities of all sizes, serving portions of 7 states, and in total, there are 127 preference utilities. Thank you for holding this hearing. I'd like to give a ratepayer perspective on the mission of BPA and on some concerns around BPA's costs and on customer value. The BPA is a ratepayer-funded agency, not supported by taxpayer dollars. It markets the renewable hydropower of 31 federal dams in the Columbia River Basin, as well as the power from the emissions-free nuclear plant. It also owns and operates 15,000 circuit miles of high-voltage transmission and has a strong history of and need for close coordination with Congress and with consumers in the region who foot the bill for BPA's operations. Preference rights to federal power were granted to these consumer-owned utilities because they passed the benefits on to the citizens. And this is a preference is just as important today as it was when it came of age in the early part of the 20th century, because it ensures that the value of these public resources accrue to the public, and it also serves as a standard against which other utilities can be measured. So BPA's core mission under the law is provision of clean, cost-based power, and the law mandates that BPA do this at the lowest possible rates to consumers consistent with sound business principles. We still have the occasional dispute with BPA, of course, about that, but in general, the agency has created very good processes in the region to outreach to customers on important policy and budget matters. Even more important is that individual utilities in the Northwest are proactively engaged and evolving with the times to meet the new challenges that the industry is facing. And I'm glad you invited Representative Craig, a caller from Snohomish PUD today, because this is a very good Northwest example of the achievements that are possible by retail utilities and the leadership that they provide at the local level. We've found that top-down directives from the outside don't work, as well as solutions that are created in the region, because the regional parties know this power system, and you know, they are already in the Bonneville area facing significant power rate increases for the second rate case in a row, and a transmission rate increase this fall as well. So our members have little tolerance for policies that create increased cost without corresponding benefits. And as an example, the chairman mentioned a troublesome top-down approach that occurred just last Thursday at the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission when it rejected key portions of the regional approach for transmission planning and cost allocation under Columbia Grid that has been working well in the Northwest. Also last year, some regulators suggested BPA should join a West-wide Energy Imbalance Market, or EIM, raising serious questions about costs and jurisdiction. So instead, utilities within the footprint of the Northwest Power Pool are analyzing regional solutions. We also find these top-down directives troubling because of how much utilities and BPA itself achieve without them, including nation-leading amounts of energy efficiency, integration of new renewable resources, and new transmission that's being built all the time. Environmental stewardship's a role we take seriously, and the Columbia system is, in fact, on track to meet important dam survival targets for salmon. There's a report out in mid-July on that. But this area continues to see increasing regulation and threats of cost that are beyond the federal system's responsibility. BPA fish costs remain around $700 million per year, 25 to 30% of the wholesale power cost, and all the while these lawsuits over the biological opinion, despite broad agreement in the region on it, drag on. It's really time for some stability and certainty in the region that will be good for fish and for the ratepayers. Finally, I'd like to just mention a large potential cost without commensurate benefit to ratepayers in the form of the Columbia River Treaty with Canada. There's a review process going on for this treaty that had focused on flood control and power. Key parts of it, though, are found now to be unbalanced, with the U.S. receiving only about one-tenth of the benefit that Canada receives. So this is a hit to electricity rates and jobs in the region. And there's some very concerning proposals now on the ecosystem side being inserted into that review process that could be very costly or increase the risk of flood control. So we're looking forward tomorrow for BPA and the Army Corps of Engineers to finally release this draft recommendation so that the customers can be more involved in that review process. I'd just like to thank you for your time today and appreciate your holding this hearing on these important issues to our customers.
Thank you, Mr. Corman, for your testimony. I'd now like to recognize Mr. Craig Caller. He's the Assistant General Manager of Power Rates and Transmission Management for Snohomish County Public Utility District located in Everett, Washington, to testify.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Napolitano, and members of the subcommittee for the opportunity to speak on this important topic today. I am Craig Caller, Assistant General Manager from Snohomish County Public Utility District. We're located just north of Seattle. We serve about 325,000 electric customers, including Boeing and Naval Station Everett, amongst our largest. We're also the 12th largest public utility in the country, and relative to this hearing today, we are the Bonneville Power Administration's single largest customer. So with that, I'd like to discuss where Snohomish believes we can best apply our resources towards the energy challenges that our region faces, and where we think Bonneville should best apply their resources. By statute, Bonneville's core mission is to deliver to the region's nonprofit consumer-owned electric utilities the clean, renewable hydropower generated at federal projects. In our view, that should be the core and represent the bulk of what Bonneville does, along with strong environmental stewardship and reliability. While Bonneville also helps advance the deployment of renewable energy and energy efficiency, It's significant to note that in many cases, these types of efforts are better led by utilities like Snohomish and others who have both the scale and the technical expertise to accomplish these goals, and of particular importance, are much closer to the ultimate consumers of these services, the utility ratepayer. I'll provide several examples of the work that we do at Snohomish that I think illustrates that point. In fact, our Board of Commissioners has established the goal of meeting load growth first with all cost-effective conservation and next with a diverse portfolio of renewable energy and no fossil fuels. In fact, we have the largest percentage of wind of any utility in the Northwest, any public utility, and just last week received the U.S. Department of Energy's Member System Award in part for our participation in the Wind Integration Forum. This is a joint initiative led by the Northwest Power and Conservation Council in Bonneville that seeks to address the growth of wind along with our existing hydropower and the integration of those jointly into the grid. As part of that effort, Snohomish is one of two regional utilities participating in a Bonneville program piloting the within-hour, the intra-hour scheduling of wind transmission, enabling the grid to better adjust to wind, adding flexibility, and we think represents a good example of a collaboration between utilities and PMAs. In addition to the acquisition of wind, Snohomish has been exceptionally active in terms of other renewable energy deployment, conservation, and grid modernization. A few examples from just recent years include the construction and commissioning of the first new hydro project in the state in over 20 years, the Youngs Creek project. We also drilled and evaluated the deepest geothermal exploration well ever drilled in the state. We launched an aggressive program to deploy a distributed solar generation within our service territory, successfully competed for over $30 million in ARA funding for grid modernization activities, including automation, cybersecurity upgrades, and fiber optic communications infrastructure. And we're currently planning deployment of the nation's first grid-connected tidal energy array in the Puget Sound. And we're also widely recognized for having a very robust and effective conservation program. Currently, we're seeking to partner with Bonneville in the deployment of a megawatt-scale battery-based energy storage project that actually aims to transform the energy storage industry through architecture and standardization. More broadly, in 2012, Bonneville coordinated the establishment of the Northwest Power Pool Members Market Assessment and Coordination Initiative to explore a range of alternatives to address the growing operational and commercial challenges in our region. And these alternatives involve not only looking at an energy imbalance market, but also at enhancements to our existing bilateral market. This effort also, we think, represents an effective collaboration in the region between Bonneville and regional utilities coming together to jointly address issues we have in the Northwest. In summary, we believe it's essential that Bonneville focus squarely on the fundamentals of delivering on their statutory obligations and to do so in the most equitable and cost-effective ways possible. As examples of our activities indicate, much of the innovation and the creativity required to meet the Northwest energy challenges can be and already are being provided by regional utilities like Snohomish and others, and we think it's vitally important that that continue. We think it's essential to ensure that Bonneville not be directed in such a way that it would duplicate, stifle, or conflict with those activities, or that would undermine BPA's ability to fully meet its existing statutory obligations. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Great. Thank you very much for your testimony. Our next witness is the Honorable Hilarion Campos, a councilman for the Tohono O'odham Nation, located in Sells, Arizona, to testify for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chairman McClintock, Ranking Member Napolitano, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. My name is Hilarion Campos, and I'm a member of the Tohono O'odham Legislative Council and chairman of both the Nation's Committee on Water Resource and Committee on Appropriations. On behalf of the Nation, I want to thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I also bring greetings and good wishes from our chairman, the Honorable Ned Norris, Jr. Before I begin, I would like to ask that the Nation's written statement be entered into the record.
Yes, without objection.
The Tohono O'odham Nation is a federally recognized Indian tribe with approximately 32,000 members. The nation's land is primarily located in four different areas within the southern and central Arizona. The nation is one of the few tribes in the U.S. that has built its own and operates its own electric utility called the Tohono O'odham Utility Authority, or TOUA. TOUA was established in 1970, making it one of the oldest tribal utilities in the United States. TOUA provides water, wastewater, telephone, cellular phone, propane, and internet service to thousands of governmental businesses and residential customers on the nation's reservation. TOA also provides electric power to numerous businesses, government buildings, schools, observatories, and residents within 56 villages throughout the Tonawatam Nation. For the nation, access to inexpensive, reliable energy is critical to addressing our basic infrastructure needs. With it, we are able to develop a kind of project that are necessary to raise our members' standard of living to one of most Americans already enjoy. TOUA purchases electricity from the Western Area Power Administration, or WAPA. The nation had a long, highly cooperative relationship with WAPA. WAPA markets and transmits power from 54 federal hydroelectric generation facilities and markets the federal government's 547 megawatt entitlement from the Nebo Generating Station. The federal power allocation and nation receives the WAPA covers 22% of the total load requirement of the Tonawatam Nation. The average cost for federal power is about 2 cents per kilowatt compared to about 9 cents from all other purchase power requirements. Federal power is saving the average residential customer $9.65 per month. These savings from federal power allocations are a significant benefit for the large number of our residential customers living below the poverty level. WAPA staff have been proactive in sharing information on the various hydropower projects, have consulted extensively with the nation, and have traveled to the reservation to meet the nation's leadership and Tonawatam utility staff to provide background and answer questions to draft power marketing criteria. WAPA and the nation are working together to improve the economic future of the Tonawatam by providing clean, reliable solar energy to consumers in the western United States through the San Lucie Farm Solar Project. The project will rely directly on the additional transmission capacity created by WAPA Electric District No. 5 Palo Verde Hub Project, or ED5-PVH. The San Lucie Farms Project will harvest the abundant solar resources of the Tonawatam Nation and create a stable, long-term revenue source that will benefit the growing Tonawatam population. The first phase of the San Lucie Farms Project is anticipated to produce approximately 20 megawatts of electricity. San Lucie Farms Project site is located immediately adjacent to the ED5-PVH project. In addition to transmission access, the site is ideally located to take advantage of some of the highest daily sunlight volumes in the United States. The nation has worked closely with WAPA and other Department of Energy staff to understand the ED5-PVH project and opportunities to provide the transmission infrastructure program to expand the capacity of its existing WAPA transmission line. In sum, WAPA has provided critical assistance, education, and support to the nation for the San Lucie Farms Project, and the nation fully supports WAPA's transmission infrastructure program and other similar programs of WAPA and United States Department of Energy. These programs are vital to the nation's economic growth, its efforts, and to provide quality life to the Tonawatam Nation and its members. Again, thank you for providing this opportunity to testify today.
Great. Thank you very much for your testimony. The chair's pleased to yield to the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Tipton, to introduce our next witness.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate your holding this hearing today on an issue of critical importance to my district. And I'd like to be able to welcome Joel Blado from Tri-State, who flew here out from Colorado specifically to testify on this topic. Tri-State plays an integral role in maintaining the economic well-being of several counties in my district. Of Tri-State's 1,500 employees, 678 are based in my congressional district. Tri-State provides high-paying jobs and is the number one source of revenue for at least two counties in my district due to the tax revenue provided by the Craig and Nucla power stations of Moffitt and Montrose counties. But the reason Joel was asked to testify is because Tri-State is one of the largest customers, if not the largest customer, of WAPA. Not only do they receive federal hydropower delivered from the Aspinall unit in my district and other federal dams, part of the Colorado River Storage Project, but they also receive 38% of their power delivery from the federal dams, part of the Missouri River Pack Sloan Basin, and in turn provide energy to a host of local power users. I look forward, Mr. Chairman, to Mr. Polito's testimony in addition to the testimony of all of our witnesses who made time to be here. Thank you, and I yield back.
Mr. Polito.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, and also Mr. Congressman Tippmann for that introduction. My name is Joel Polito, and I said I represent Tri-State, but also my views are shared by a number of customer organizations that represent WAPA customers throughout their regions. There was a letter attached to my written testimony that really you see how many various customer groups there are in Western's territory. And it goes back to really, I think, the foundation of WAPA. And both the chairman and the ranking member mentioned how regional-focused WAPA has been over its existence. You've got North Dakota to Wyoming to Colorado, Arizona, California. They're all different. And part of the success of WAPA and really the success we've seen of the agency has been the ability to work in these regions and work collectively with the local utilities, with the local customer community to optimize the solutions for us, as opposed to a top-down approach that typically sub-optimizes everything we've tried to do over the last 30, 40, 50 years. In fact, we believe that you might say the secret sauce of why Western has been such a successful agency is because of these regional partnerships and this regional focus. Another thing is really the partnerships. Again, I heard a number of times folks talk about making sure we actively communicate between the customers and the agency. And Chairman Hastings also talked about the need to work together for new initiatives. The federal power customers actually have put their money where their mouth is on this. We've partnered with WAPA over the years to great success. I think we have helped keep electricity rates affordable working with WAPA over the years, and that's been very important. When they needed new transmission, we helped work with them. And a thing to remember is WAPA does not have any load growth responsibilities. WAPA markets the federal resource and works with us, the customers, in order to make sure that we can serve our growing needs in partnership with them. In fact, in the PIC Sloan program, over about the last 10 years, the customers have provided $500 million to the Corps, the Bureau, and WAPA to rebuild their system. So not only have we rebuilt and modernized our system, we're helping make sure that WAPA system's rebuilt and in good condition. Because there's nobody that cares more about making sure the reliability of the system is out there than us, who take care of the customers at the end of the line, and many of our members who do the same thing. You know, in any successful organization, I think WAPA is maybe a victim of its own success here. When I think other agencies see an organization's had great success, strong customer relations, they think, well, we'll put some more mission on them and see if they can't do more things that we can't seem to accomplish. And that's some of the concerns we have going forward with WAPA. One is the change I call a change of management model. Historically, this regional approach, working directly with the customers, has yielded great success. Starting with the CHU memo last year and now the access to capital, there appears to be a more top-down approach now. And our concern is, if you standardize Western or try to across all of these vast regions, then we all as customers, whether you're in Arizona, Colorado, or California, have to change what you're doing to match WAPA, and that could, in the end, cost the consumers a lot of money. Western saves a little, we all pay a lot. So I think that's why the partnership is so important. And we're concerned that this change of management focus could be detrimental to the rates. Also, I call it shifting of the organizational focus. Historically, WAPA is an operating entity. They have real customers, us. They have real transmission assets. They market power from real power plants. And when they don't do their job well, real people's lights go off. And so when you start looking as being a test bed for innovative ideas and policies and technologies, There are customers you're talking about, my members, that say we may not want to be in that boat. We would rather have reliable, affordable energy. Let other parts of the Department of Energy, who are very well suited for policy development and for technology deployment, have them do their job. That's really not a role WAPA fills very well. Also, they aren't getting increased appropriations, and therefore that comes out of existing resources, which mean there's less to do their traditional mission. And then the last one that concerns us going forward is really the long-term impact of regulations, be environmental, new FERC regulations, which sometimes are very rigid and really don't allow for some of the special things you see on the Power Marketing Administration's grid. In fact, at Glen Canyon, over the last number of years, it's been $50 million a year for environmental constraints. Now, Tri-State and the other customers have worked well with WAPA and look forward to working with them in the future. And I look forward to answering any questions the committee may have. Thank you.
Great. Thank you for your testimony. The chair is pleased to yield to the gentleman from California, Mr. LaMalfa, to introduce our next witness.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member. I'm pleased to be able to introduce Mr. Barry Tippin here, who has joined us from Reading. He serves as a director as the City of Reading's electric utility there, as well as the assistant manager for the city, where he's been since 2008. Which focuses on the day-to-day operation of the city. Also before that, as a civil engineer, he served 13 years at California Department of Transportation, and we're really glad to have his testimony here because he's uniquely qualified to discuss the issues before us and how his analysis can provide a direct input on the decisions we need to make here in Washington for energy customers. Also joining him is Elizabeth Hadley from Reading Electric, who handles the regulatory issues for the city and the utility. And also, it's just really good to have this opportunity to address the spiraling costs in general of the Central Valley Project Improvement Act, which has really no defined metrics or date to determine when the Act's goals have been reached. So the failure of the Act to include defined completion has resulted in continual cost to water and power ratepayers who are served by the Central Valley Project long after the Act's many of the goals have been achieved. Of course, these costs have directly related in rate increases to Central Valley electrical customers, and in some years have driven costs above market rate. So it's high time that the Act be reexamined. Again, Mr. Chairman, thanks for this opportunity and from our witnesses here today.
Thank you, Chairman McClintock, Ranking Member Napolitano, Congressman LaMalfa, and members of the subcommittee. I want to thank you for holding this hearing today, as my colleagues have mentioned, and for the opportunity to testify regarding the City of Reading's perspective on power marketing administrations. I would like to refer you to my written testimony, which was submitted as part of the record. As noted, my name is Barry Tippin. I am the director of the City of Reading's electric utility and has been in existence since 1921, has 43,000 electric customers, and is governed directly by our City Council. Reading executed its first contract with the Western Area Power Authority, or WAPA, for hydroelectric energy from the Central Valley Project, or CVP, in the 1960s, and currently receives nearly 8% of the electricity output from the CVP hydro system, which is roughly 30% of Reading's power supply. Reading's electrical distribution system is interconnected to WAPA's transmission system and is dependent on the reliability of WAPA's system. Reading's more than simply a WAPA customer, we're partners. Today, I'd like to discuss three issues that concern Reading due to their current and potential impact on WAPA's rates: DOE's efforts to alter WAPA's core mission, WAPA's access to capital initiative, and the Central Valley Project Improvement Act Restoration Fund. The March 2012 memo from DOE Secretary Chu proposing significant structural changes to the PMAs caught the PMA customers by surprise. As you might have noticed, the DOE issued edicts to achieve change rather than to collaborate. What transpired after the issuance of that memo was a predictable response. Although in the final report, the joint outreach team recognized that WAPA has a number of initiatives already underway, there's still much uncertainty as to the timeline for implementation and corresponding studies, how these activities will be funded, and exactly how the customers will be included in the study process. Reading sincerely thanks the subcommittee for voicing their concerns that DOE's plans, which lacked both congressional and customer input, could increase electricity costs for utility customers with little, if any, associated benefits. Recently, WAPA has been pursuing the Access to Capital Initiative, as you've heard. The intent is to identify and develop a long-term funding strategy. Frankly, I do not understand WAPA's premise that it does not have adequate mechanisms already in place to meet its capital funding needs in order to fulfill congressionally authorized core mission to deliver federal hydropower. WAPA's regions, in close collaboration with their customers, have each developed capital funding tools compatible with their needs and statutory authorities. CVP power contractors worked with the Bureau of Reclamation and WAPA Sierra Nevada region to develop the CVP operations and maintenance funding program in order to secure an adequate funding source to properly maintain the CVP facilities. This funding agreement was executed in 1997, and customers have provided nearly $300 million of advanced funding for Bureau of Reclamation and WAPA projects. Federal hydropower from the CVP system has been one of the most cost-effective renewable and carbon-free resources in the Redding's power portfolio. However, CVP power costs have increased disproportionately in recent years due to the increasing costs associated with environmental mitigation provisions in the CVPIA. Since its inception in 1992, over $1.5 billion has been spent on restoration activities through funds collected by surcharges on water and power contractors. Redding's customers currently contribute over $2 million annually to the restoration fund. CVP power contractor assessments that average less than $10 million per year have skyrocketed to more than $25 million in recent times. While Redding supports the restoration goals of the CVPIA, Redding is concerned over the lack of oversight and accountability of the restoration fund. Redding believes that Congress intended these restoration activities to be completed within 10 years of the law's enactment. We are now over 20 years and $1.5 billion in the program with questionable success in restoring fish populations. Redding thanks this committee for its efforts and passage of H.R. 1837 in 2011, which included amendments to the CVPIA requiring programmatic and fiscal accountability and that all restoration projects be completed by 2020. We encourage the subcommittee to continue to push for a solution to the CVPIA restoration fund's escalating costs that appear to continue into perpetuity and has drastic impacts on the economic viability of the CVP power. Redding Electric Utility and its ratepayers have benefited from a long-standing partnership with WAPA. However, top-down, non-core program pressures and other initiatives create uncertainty that the CVP will remain an economical resource. In closing, let me say on behalf of Redding City Council and its residents that we appreciate the due diligence this committee provides in its oversight of the PMAs, and I thank you once again for holding this hearing.
Thank you for your testimony. The chair is now pleased to yield to the gentleman from Oklahoma, Mr. Mullen, to introduce our final witness.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It is my pleasure to introduce my constituent and fellow Oklahoman to this subcommittee, Mr. Ted Combs from Ketchum on Grand Lake. Mr. Combs currently serves as the director or executive director of Southwestern Power Resource Association, which represents the rural electric cooperatives and municipally owned electric utilities that purchase hydropower generated at Corps of Engineers dams in Oklahoma and other states in our region. Ted also currently serves as chairman of the Oklahoma Waterways Advisory Board, which advises Oklahoma Governor Mary Fallon, the state legislator, and the Oklahoma Department of Transportation on these issues affecting the McKern navigational system. Mr. Combs is not a stranger to this subcommittee and water power resource issues here in Washington. He formerly served as the Director of Government Relations for the Oklahoma or the American Power Association here in town, and also worked for the former Congressman Wes Watkins, which I might point out, he started here in 1977, which was the year I was born. Not making any suggestions there, but
we're not going to do that kind of
thing. But if wisdom is in years, he has a lot of wisdom to give us. So, Mr. Combs, thank you for the subcommittee and appreciate you coming. I kind of stepped in it there, didn't I?
Thank you, Congressman. I knew you were Mr. Chairman, Ranking Minority Member Napolitano, my congressman and the rest of the subcommittee, again, thank you for honoring me to ask me to come up and talk to you. The congressman's kind of told you what I do, who we are. We represent the customers of Southwestern Power Administration. Those customers are in six states. Ultimately, about 8 million people get the benefit of that federal hydropower. I came to talk to you about four things, and I'll try to be brief because all the details are in that written testimony. The first is a thing called the Jonesboro MOA. The second is the need for a special receipts and disbursement account at Treasury. The third is implementation of Section 1222 of the Energy Policy Act of 2005. And the fourth is what I refer to as mission creep. Now, what is this thing called the Jonesboro MOA? Well, let me give you a little background about how it came about. When I first took this job back in 1995, you were born then, that's when we began to notice that we were having more and more forced outages at core hydropower plants. And that forced Southwestern to go out and purchase expensive on-peak thermal energy to replace that to meet its contractual obligations to the people I represent. to the ratepayers. And that has raised our prices. And we also noticed that those outages, that increase in outages, coincides with the reduced appropriations to the Corps for its hydropower operation, maintenance, replacement, and rehabilitation program. Now, that coincidence is not a coincidence. We think they're directly related. Consequently, we had to come up with a way, because from our perspective, it's pay me now or pay me later. We pay all those costs, plus interest on the capital costs. We turn it all to the Treasury. And consequently, if we could find a way to keep those forced outages from happening with planned outages, then we could save our customers a lot more money, still get the job done. So to bring that together in cooperation with the Corps of Engineers and with Southwestern Power Administrations and the customers, they put together this three-part agreement called the Jonesboro Memorandum of Agreement, or Jonesboro MOA. And what it, way it works is that the Corps, the customers, and Southwestern sit down once a year and look at the list of projects that need to be done in major rehabilitation replacement. They decide what's the biggest priority and how much we can afford to spend in the next fiscal year. We rank those, and then we fund down to our level of what we can afford. And this has enabled us, since we started this process in 1999, we have funded 212 major pieces of replacement equipment and are replaced, we've replaced 212 projects with replacement equipment at a cost of more than $305 million from the customers. Now, the Corps has what's called a reinvestment, recapitalization plan, because all of its hydropower plants are in similar situation across the country. And so we have pledged to the Corps that we can, through the Jonesboro MOA, raise the $2.4 billion we think it's going to take over the next 30 years to rehab all 24 of those projects. Other customer groups are dealing with the same problem. They're dealing with it in their unique way due to the situation they have and the laws they're working with. But we're all coming to grasp with, and I think it's a great success story upon our part and customers and other groups finding how to address this problem of not enough appropriated dollars to meet the need. The second thing is the special receipts and disbursement account. You know, Southwestern has, working with its customers, we put together rate structures because hydrologic conditions change from year to year. So while your average annual energy that is not what you get every year. Some years you get more, some years you get less. When you get less, you have to buy thermal power to supplement that to meet your load. That can cause your rates to swing like this. As I said, we work together to level those things out, and we've had great success. But what we want to do is pre-collect from the customers money for purchased power, have it in the Treasury in a special fund so that we can draw that out when needed. Third is Section 1222 of the Energy Policy Act of 2005, which allows Southwestern and Western to cooperate with other entities, including privately held power companies, to build transmission projects. We're working through that. We have a project in our region now that's applied for that. Our concern is protecting the customers from liability, and they have agreed to work with us. Clean Line has agreed to work with us in addressing that problem. Mission creep, I'll have to get to later, Mr. Chairman, because time creep got up on me.
We'll try to get to that in the questions, which are going to begin right now, as a matter of fact. And let me begin by just asking, starting Mr. Corwin, what's the most expensive form of electricity that you purchase?
I might defer to Snohomish. The individual utilities might have some expensive, especially those that are under the renewable portfolio standards in the West. So it'd be forms of renewables.
Let me go to Mr. Combs. And Mr. Combs, what's the most expensive form of electricity you folks purchase?
In terms of the PMA, the most expensive power they purchase, which they in turn resell to us, is on-peak thermal energy that's required when the hydropower resource is insufficient to meet the load.
Okay, Mr. Blado.
We have a 30-megawatt solar farm in New Mexico, and I think that is the highest cost resource we have.
Okay, Mr. Tippin.
Obviously, I would temper that by saying it's somewhat of a complicated question at times, but our wind project from Bighorn, although it's a tremendous contract for us, signed in 2002, firmed and shaped to the Oregon border, it runs about 9 cents, which is our most expensive.
And what's the cheapest form of electricity you purchase, Mr. Coombs?
Again, the cheapest energy we can receive is the hydropower we get from Southwestern.
Mr. Blayo?
WAPA Hydropower.
Mr. Tippin?
WAPA Hydropower.
And yet, for some reason, we're no longer building hydroelectric facilities, but pouring tons of money into wind and solar, the most expensive forms of electricity that are available. That sounds like a rather convoluted policy to me, but we'll go on. You know, each of you represent ratepayers that have paid for federal hydropower generation and the transmission necessary to deliver that power. Historically, what's the process used to determine the rates of the for the generation and transmission of federal power? Mr. Blito?
Traditionally, we would be meeting with WAPA and talking about their needs and what the system conditions are. And then once we've identified and you might say agreed to some of the enhancements that need to be made, identified the hydrology, they would then do their public process to establish the rates that are needed.
So it's essentially collaborative.
It's a collaborative process.
Did the directors in the CHU memo reflect that kind of collaboration?
No, they did not.
The Department of Energy targeted the Western Area Power Administration as a test case for the CHU memo. Customers, with the help of Congress, beat back many of the memo's original proposals that would have increased costs, yet the most recent recommendations are still concerning, according to the testimonies we've heard today, including yours. Could you describe those concerns?
Yeah, our concern, again, is that shift to top-down command and control, where they really don't take our input and help formulate the solutions. As I said before, they kind of launch down a road and ask us for feedback on the road they are on. Instead of identifying right up front, is there a better way to do it like we've historically done, and it's been very successful historically. So same with the CHU memo.
Now, you said you're integrating solar energy, Mr. Tippin. You said you're integrating wind energy into your system. Obviously, you're not doing it because it's the cheapest form of electricity available. You've just testified that it's the most expensive available to you, respectively. So are you integrating it because it's the most reliable form of electricity available?
We are under a RPS, or a renewable portfolio standard, in two of our states, and part of our requirement then is to have a certain amount of renewables on our system. That is what drove us to our initial purchases of renewables.
Well, why? I assume that's because it's the most reliable form of electricity you have available. Then, because it's obviously not the most, it's obviously the most expensive, so you must be getting something for that. Is it reliability?
We're meeting the requirements of the law in the states that require us to have renewables.
Yes. That you're talking around the question. Mr. Tippin, is this most reliable, is your wind power the most reliable you have available?
For our case, it is very reliable because we've paid for it to be firmed and shaped, but generally speaking, wind power is not a reliable source. It's intermittent by its nature.
Because the wind stops blowing from time to time, the generators stop generating, and then you have to be ready to immediately back that up with thermal power, don't you?
That's correct.
And you've got to keep those thermal turbines running 24/7 in order to back up that power when there's an unpredictable loss of wind or solar electricity. Is that correct?
Yeah, either that or pay for new.
So we run these plants 24/7 just like we always have. The only difference is they're not generating any electricity. They're waiting to step in to replace the electricity that we lose when when a cloud passes over a solar array or the wind stops blowing. Is that essentially correct?
Yes.
And isn't that insane? That'll be a rhetorical question. I'm now out of time. I'll yield now to the ranking member for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I love what you're talking about in terms of availability of hydro, assuming we will have plenty of water. Right? Assuming we have plenty of water to turn those turbines, right, for hydro. So if we don't have alternatives, then what will happen? Will you be able to provide? Does rolling blackouts continue? So that becomes something that we need to understand. It's going to have to be part of the challenge that we face, and how are we facing it? And insofar as the rate, I'm asking for some questions for the record later, Mr. Chair. in regard to the cost of hydro versus when the partners loan, if you will, the PMAs to be able to do their infrastructure repair, whatever, that you get cheaper power. Am I correct? You can purchase power at a cheaper rate. You get credits for it, in other words. Am I correct? Okay. What is the difference between that and what you would pay? I know the Tohono O'odham Nation normally has 0.019, right, per kilowatt hour. Am I correct, sir?
With all due respect, my capacity at this level is at the governmental level. So, with the question that you're asking, what I would have to further. That's a technical question
right.
that I would have to ask my. But however,
right.
I will follow up on that.
Thank you. Well, my concern is we're not going to have any more water if Mother Nature keeps putting these drought cycles upon us. So how are we going to meet those demands? How are we going to continue to be able to produce hydropower, to be able to fulfill your obligations without not only the efficiencies that most of you have already worked on, but also the development of green and other power? Anybody?
What I would say is that in Reading we have historically had good water deliveries, and so we do have our drought years and we have our high water years. And to back that at times, we have purchased and constructed our own generation. That generation is powered by natural gas, and so we do have a portfolio of natural gas that helps generate that when we don't receive enough hydropower. We also have a robust process where we can purchase off the market. And as I mentioned, you know, we have a 33% requirement for California for renewables, so
right.
we also have that within our portfolio. So we have we're an integrated utility. We have access to transmission, we have generation, and so we use those in combination to make the most economical dispatch for power.
Could you answer, Mr. Cutler, how does the cost of efficiency compare with other energy resources?
Sure. It depends, of course, on the efficiency measure that we're talking about. What could be lighting, HVAC, heat pumps, any number of things. What we typically do is use the Northwest Power and Conservation Council's methodology to really pursue all cost-effective and technically achievable conservation, which by definition is that conservation that we can acquire that's less than our avoided cost of going to the supply side of the curve. So it depends on where that's at. Could be somewhere around $70 or $80 a megawatt hour, but that gives you a general sense of what our avoided cost might be looking into the future a bit for conservation.
Anybody else want to comment? Again, Mr. Cutler, I understand the Northwest Power Pool, which includes utilities in the Pacific Northwest and Northern California, has been examining a range of tools to help integrate the renewable resources into the regional electric grid. What kinds of tools are you studying, and what the study results show thus far, and how do the public power utilities think this process should play out?
Sure, this would be the initiative that I mentioned earlier. Specifically, that team is looking at an energy imbalance market as well as enhancements to the bilateral market that we have now.
Mm-hmm.
So starting just briefly with the energy imbalance market, at least what we've seen so far in terms of the potential benefits from that market, they look pretty modest, maybe on the order of 1% of the total production cost of generation on the Northwest Power Pool footprint, which to us at least is not particularly compelling. Also, when you consider the fact that the cost to set up the market, to participate in the market, to manage the market, to monitor the market, you know, if those costs are a little higher than you think they might be, if the benefits are a little lower, there are credible scenarios by which the net present value of an initiative could actually be negative. So while we wouldn't take it off the table, we certainly wouldn't put an energy imbalance market at the top of the list of the activities we could be pursuing to solve the challenges that we're looking at. We think that that money and that effort currently is much better spent on enhancements to the bilateral market, which in any case are a bit more transparent, a little bit more easier to quantify, and also would form a solid foundation for an EAM should it make sense to implement one in the future.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Ms. Lummis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen, for your testimony today. First, some questions about former Energy Secretary Chu's memo with regard to electric vehicle refueling stations and wind and solar integration strategies for WAPA. I know that some of you asked that this memo be softened. It was. I know some of you have concerns that it still may be problematic. Firstly, question for Mr. Blado. In spite of the Department of Energy softening on the Chu memo, do you remain concerned about implementing those recommendations, and can you describe why?
We still have our concerns because a lot of them were we will, in the future, look at doing some of these things, and based on the track record of the Chu memo of and of coming out of nowhere, taking us by surprise, we want to make sure the collaborative process and there's a good examination to weigh all of the benefits, good and bad, so you get a more balanced approach. Could be good for WAPA and really bad for the customers. We want to make sure the sum of those two benefits are what drives the decision. We're always looking for saving cost and innovation given the times are changing here, but we just want to be included in that discussion and make sure it actually makes sense and not driven from somebody somewhere else that feels it makes sense that doesn't know the particulars of the region they're dealing with.
Who pays the costs of WAPA?
The customers pay all the costs through our rates. So if there is an initiative that doesn't work so well, it will go into our power rates. If there's one that works very well, it will help reduce our rates. But we, at the end of the day, it all goes into the cost, or all goes into our power rates.
And can you remind me, what is the core mission of WAPA?
The core mission of WAPA is to deliver federal hydropower over its system to preference customers. And that is what they have done very successfully, and their predecessor, the Bureau, has for decades and decades. And they do a good job at that piece of their mission.
So is the mission changing? Is it creeping to where it's to provide high-cost power that's experimental?
I hope not. I think as missions get added on in terms of enhancing the grid for other purposes, in effect, that falls on the back of the existing ratepayers to finance that. If it ends up being a bad decision, we'll bear the cost of that. So that's our concern is if you're not very good at projecting these things, and it's a tough thing to do, we could easily end up on the wrong side of the accounts there.
I also have some questions about the current decentralized approach and this new approach, which would centralize WAPA. The current approach, focusing on cheap, clean energy to customers who rely on Western or WAPA to power their towns, is that all reflected in the Chu memo, or is the rollout of the new access to capital fund a reflection of the mission, the traditional mission of WAPA?
Well, I think there's where there's some room for dialogue and debate with WAPA. We feel that we fund that core mission fairly well, and that $500 million we've advanced in just one of WAPA's projects has really kept the system in very good shape. The concern we have is as these other missions fall in, who's going to finance them? Are they going to be on our back, or is the taxpayers going to take the risk? And then if it doesn't work out so well, will it fall on our back? So that's our concerns.
I'd also like to ask Mr. Tippin to weigh in on some of these. Do you have thoughts on this line of questioning?
We very much feel the same way that Mr. Blado does. The process that went through the Chu memo, and that's being followed also with the access to capital, seems to have a theme of decisions being made at a central location and then pushed out through webinars or memos or emails and other fashions, as opposed to having stakeholder meetings where we're able to collaborate on what the problem is. One of the things that we continue to ask is what is the issue with the current capital funding processes that we have? We're not aware of any capital funding needs that the Sierra Nevada region has had over the past 14 years that haven't been met through the current process.
So, Mr. Blado, back to you. You've expressed in writing concern about the access to capital initiative, is that correct?
That is correct.
And are you satisfied with the justifications you've received?
No, that's our issue also is We've provided a lot of resource. We've partnered with Western to meet the needs, and we're struggling to see why this new initiative is needed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Tipton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Blato, we come from the same part of the country, and as you're well aware, we're seeing devastating wildfires in Colorado. In my district right now, we have over 460 square miles of out-of-control forest fire that's taking place. When we look at Secretary Chu's memo in March of 2012, is it your sense that WAPA is maybe being turned into a test bed for policy initiatives for the Department of Energy? And how do you see this impacting transmission lines that are going through some of these forest lands?
Well, I think that's one of the concerns we have on a long-term basis. Traditionally, WAPA has done a very good job of operating and maintaining their system. But when you put more mission on the same people without additional resources, you start diluting the focus of what they're doing. And that would be a concern of mine is as you go in the future, something has to give when you have those multiple masters and you have new direction. And if you have a lot of wildfires, will their emergency preparedness suffer? Will they have fewer linemen in the field? I don't know. We haven't seen it to date, but in the future, if you end up with other missions, something has to give. And that's our concern is what would give in the future.
Certainly. You know, Mr. Gosar and I were able to get a bill through the House for small hydroelectric units going through the Bureau of Rec Canals. Is that sort of a policy, a good idea to be able to help you fulfill your mission?
I think that's a good policy. It allows optimal use of those resources. I mean, the water's there, and if they're cost effective for somebody to put a generator on there, I think that's good for a lot of times the irrigators that are our members. And could utilize that. I think it's a good idea, yes.
Right. You know, I'd like to go back to Ms. Lemus's question a little bit in terms of the core mission of WAPA, and that's to be able to take advantage of hydroelectric power. But as we've heard testimony, we have to be able to rely also on thermal energy to be able to create that as well. Is there some real concern we have with the president now coming out bypassing the Congress of the United States with his directives to be able to achieve certain goals? We all want affordable energy. Is this going to be a real risk when we look at areas that I've mentioned when I introduced you for the nuclear power plant, the coal-fired power plant up in Craig, Colorado? And are we missing a great opportunity to look for new technologies to be able to actually deliver clean, affordable coal energy to keep those rates down?
Yeah, that's something we, Tri-State, has spent a lot of time and effort on our production side is how do we meet, how can we meet the new emissions regulations, can we meet them, and are there new technologies to help us eliminate or reduce significantly the things coming out of there that concern the EPA. We feel that that reliable baseload power is so important to keeping the cost affordable to our members that we definitely want to explore what technologies can we use to make sure that we can continue to rely on those plants into the future.
You know, I get a sense, and maybe some of the other members of the panel would like to jump on this as well. There's a real concern in this panel for the ultimate end consumer, because you just mentioned about the possibility, well, are the taxpayers going to pick up the bill as opposed to Western Area Power? Bottom line, it's always the taxpayer that picks up the bill, be it as a ratepayer or it's going to be actually through taxes. And when we look at the title of this hearing, the Power Marketing Administration, a ratepayer's perspective, it's my sense from you that one of your real big objectives is to be deeply concerned about senior citizens that are on fixed incomes seeing their power bills go up, young families trying to be able to struggle and provide for their children, seeing more and more of their paychecks being taken away by taxation via regulation. Would you maybe like to comment on that?
Yeah, I'll start off. I know we serve a lot of rural areas. In fact, the majority of our 200,000 square miles is rural. It's areas that are underserved or traditionally weren't economical. And so we do have a lot of lower income folks out there. We have tribal members. We have a lot of diversity out there. And it is always on the back of our minds and our members we serve that how do we keep the electricity affordable?
So may I interrupt you real quickly? We're running out of time. So some of the mandates now that are coming out of Washington Are those inhibiting that mission to be able to deliver affordable energy to the struggling people that you just described?
Yes, all of them have a cost.
All of them have a cost. Mr. Chairman, I'm out of time. I yield back. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. Mr. Gosar.
Thank you. Mr. Campos, I'm so glad the ranking lady asked you the question because I can answer that for you, is that when you don't get that water power, you have a coal fire plant that is the cheapest one that provides power for you. So, you know, here in Arizona, we have a number of coal fire plants that provide that backup as baseline. So that's the answer. Mr. Campos, once again, the coal-fired plant, the Navajo Generating Station, powers the pumps that deliver water to some of the areas on your reservation. Is that true?
That is correct.
Does this water provide critical resources like food and jobs that are critical to your tribe's economic livelihood?
The water itself does have some impact on our agriculture, say like at our some of our farms that we do have on our on the nation, that the water provides for agriculture needs.
So it does, because if you didn't have it, you wouldn't be having the same type of agriculture that you have today.
Correct.
Thank you. Since you're the direct beneficiary of a coal-fired electricity plant that provides pumping power and thousands of jobs throughout Arizona, is the nation, the Tohono O'odham, part of the tribal coalition, including the Navajos, the Hopis, and the Gila River Indian community, working to keep the plant open?
Yes, we are.
Are you concerned by the EPA's regulations that could close a plant or make your allocation of CAP water unaffordable?
Well, from what I understand with the recent EPA to change out the production of that the plant itself to go to a more cleaner energy source, and that's why we're looking at allowing them to continue that route.
Okay. Mr. Bladow, going back to my colleague from Colorado's line of questioning, you got lots of infrastructure out in the forest. How can we better maintain that?
Yeah, I think one of the challenges we have is we have so many different property owners when you have thousands and thousands of miles of transmission line, distribution line, and the more we can understand the rules of how to trim back the right of way to make sure the clearing is proper and we don't have trees and other contact that can perhaps start a fire, I think that would help us eliminate that. And there are some programs we did, one in western Colorado where we partnered and helped clear a wider swath through the forest, which really helped the Forest Service in a fire break and also helped the utilities clear a really good corridor there.
But it would be best if we were to work collaboratively together to have a common sense one application that allows some flexibility, would it not, in maintenance?
That would be great for utilities, yes.
Because particularly in these forest fire areas, they're very regional and there's very different rules for different applications, BLM versus Forest Service. Are you aware that both Congressman Tipton and I both work together quite a bit, that we individually introduced that would provide for a streamlined process of thinning and other forest health initiatives around critical infrastructure? Are you aware of those?
I am not aware of them.
Is this something that you think that the water and power users like the members of the Colorado River Energy Distribution Association would support?
Yes, I think it would be one.
Wonderful. Let me ask you another question. I mean, you also have interest in coal fire plants, do you not, Mr. Bladow?
Yes, we do.
Are you concerned about what the president said yesterday?
Yes, we are.
So there's absolutely no room in his agenda for coal, right? It's a war on coal.
I think it's going to be challenging.
Well, I know it's going to be challenged, not if. It's going to be challenged. And I think Arizona's going to do it. So I want him to point his attention, since he's got that focus on Arizona, just to make sure he knows exactly who's coming. Do you see it as a problem when you're trying to deliver baseline energy, particularly with a portfolio like Arizona and Colorado and a lot of the southern or southwestern states? Do you see the problem if you were to eliminate one source of energy?
Oh, absolutely. Today, the system is built around existing plants, and it's going to take a lot of time to transition the transmission system to where it can even operate if you eliminate some of these key power stations along the way. And we're seeing that in western Colorado, where one of our stations may not continue to operate, and we're really struggling to see how we can reliably meet the loads in that area without that plant online.
Well, and I want to pick on this a little bit, because what they talked about was regional haze in regards to particulates, particularly out of the Navajo Generating Station. I mean, what they're even trying to enforce here actually does nothing in regards to the Grand Canyon. They've picked on this coal-fired plant in regards to the Grand Canyon, and it doesn't even provide any type of regional haze. I mean, it'd be more from the California aspects and probably China than it does from the power plant. In fact, I want to bring up one of them that was actually shut down, Mojave, that was shut down over in Kingman, which is due west of the Grand Canyon. And even the studies prove that there was nothing that actually changed within the viewpoint of the Grand Canyon. I've run out of time, so thank you very much.
We're going to go to second round if you have the time. Mr. Mullen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, Oklahoma, we kind of find ourselves in a unique situation here. A lot of people may consider wind a natural resource or not, but Oklahoma is rich in natural resources. I mean, we have coal, we have water, we have oil, we have timber, and we have wind. Even in our state song, it talks about the wind sweeping down the plains, and there's a reason for that, because it's there. And so we kind of always want to be looking 3-4 steps ahead, although the idea that the White House is forcing us to go this way really frustrates me. It's not the will of the people, it's the will of this administration, and there's a fine balance that has to be there. In this country, we've always prided ourselves on ingenuity, and that's why we're always a step ahead, and that's why we're always the leading in the country and in the world when it comes to energy. And with that being said, Mr. Combs, there's a proposal or an application that's been brought to your attention from Clean Line Energy, and I know you're looking over this. This is part of your jurisdiction. Do you have any concerns with Clean Line and their approach to what they're trying to get accomplished with harnessing the wind?
Our concern is not their objective. We have problems with the project itself. Our concern is potential liabilities to that project. You never do know who's going to sue whom or who's going to have financial problems. And Section 5 of the Flood Control Act of 44 requires Southwestern customers to pick up all the costs of operating. And if that cost gets passed on over to us, then we assume that was
even the cost of operating Clean Line's project?
We asked DOE if Section 1222 replaced or obviated Section 5 of the Flood Control Act 44, and they said no. So we're concerned that ultimately, if there's a cost the Southwestern bears, it'll have to go into our rate base. Now, Clean Line, to their effort, is making every effort to solve our concerns with that.
Even if their project isn't tied on to the grid, it still holds Southwest liable for it?
It depends upon the nature of the work Southwestern does for them. If Southwestern acquires right-of-way, there could be liability arising from that.
Are they asking right now for you to help with right of way, or are they doing it on the?
That is a consideration, because the Clean Line Partners, as I understand it, do not have utility status yet in the state of Arkansas. So one of the aspects they're looking at Southwestern doing is acquiring right of way in Arkansas and, if necessary, in Oklahoma. But it's not clear whether it's going to be necessary in Oklahoma.
So what would you like to see from Clean Line to protect your customers? Protect us. I'm assuming what you're trying to do is protect us. I'm part of that grid, so you're trying to protect us. So what does Clean Line need to do to protect our rates?
To their credit, sir, they've reached out to us, and they've said we'd like to solve your concerns about that. And so they're looking at contractual provisions that they'll have with Southwestern Power Administration to try to hold us, harm us under any condition you could imagine. In addition, they're looking at other vehicles, such as an insurance fund or insurance of a sort, to take care of any liability like that.
Have you proposed anything to them yet, or anything that this body could help with?
We have been in touch with them, and we have met on the phone, and we continue to work together to identify all those potential liabilities so we can try to deal with them. Ultimately, I'm sure it would be in Clean Line's best interest not to seek a legislative remedy, and I understand that. And our hope is we can solve this without a legislative remedy.
Well, I appreciate that. And Mr. Chairman, I yield back the remainder of my time.
Thank you. Mr. LaMalfa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple of questions, thoughts for Mr. Tippin here, specific to CVPIA. My understanding, the Bureau had a study commissioned in 2006 to analyze status of restoration projects, and as well as the completeness of them, I'm curious about too. And how do you, kind of backing into that, how you define the completeness of a project as by who, but what overall is the conclusion of the study? And I'm kind of curious, you have to have a study by one agency over the projects of another. Wouldn't it be simpler if it was just a report instead of studying them? But how do you define the completeness of them, and what is the conclusion of the study?
Well, if my recollection is correct, there's 32 or 34 activities that are mentioned within the Act itself, and that report claimed that 8 were complete of that 34. Some of them are very easy to define, such as temperature curtain at Shasta Lake, at Shasta Dam. That's a fairly defined project that can get completed in construction, and when we do a certificate of completion, it's done. Other projects are more nebulous. They're related to the restoration of fisheries within Sacramento River, for instance. And it's very subjective as to what's complete. I believe the Act mentions doubling the fish population.
Subjective because is there not a goal going into the restoration of a...
Yeah, the Act itself is nebulous in terms of what completion would be. And so what that report you're referring to states is that it will be many more years and several hundred millions of dollars to reach completion. And even at that stage, I'm not sure what completion would be defined as.
So we're not allowed to define what completion is on a restoration project. We don't have a set goal of when we get X amount of fish or X amount of habitat that we know we're finished.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any definitive completion metrics that we would be using to measure right now.
Well, we should just leave the checkbook open and the credit card. You don't have to answer that. What do you see over the lifetime of CVIA on the costs and the acceleration of those costs?
As I mentioned in my testimony, the cost over the last 5 years have escalated tremendously. Some of that's due to lack of water, as has been mentioned. Some of it has to do with the fact that the Bureau has come to the conclusion that the amount of money that was estimated to be needed in the first place was underestimated by a tremendous amount. So, in order to even begin to achieve the completion, the costs are going to be astronomical, above what was planned. And so what I see is that if we don't find a way to put boundaries and parameters on these projects, we don't find a way to decide what those metrics are, define those costs.
A cost-benefit ratio, perhaps?
Any manner of defining the project impacts and the necessary mitigations. Any project you start today has defined mitigations before the project go forward. We're doing this in arrears, but nonetheless, I believe that we should still be working towards that defined mitigation for the projects at hand.
I agree. Lastly, when we're talking about when you look at these costs skyrocketing, as you mentioned in your testimony here, then that affects the ratepayers are paying for their electricity, because they still have to make it up as a defined number amount, not an amount per kilowatt, for example, right?
That's correct. We pay for a set price on the CVP power. We pay 8% of the cost of CVP, no matter how much hydro.
So less hydro produced, the more the cost per unit produced is going to go back.
In addition, we have to replace that with more expensive energy forms.
Correct. Some of the higher costs that depends on whether it's cloudy or windy, right?
Correct.
Okay. So what we have going on with the so-called energy policy is that we're in this country attacking fracturing, which has made a lot more options available for petroleum and gas. Going after coal, it looks like. We have new taxes on domestically produced oil being proposed in California and other places. We're stopping the Keystone Project. and the hydro front, we have proposals to remove dams, proposals to build more, as was thought of years ago, or raise existing dams, get held up. And we do see the reprioritizing of water that exists. How are we going to have any hydro around with all of these things going on, or these other types of energy that keep costs down on electricity? And if we did, if climate change is a factor, if we want to give that, and we're talking about water supply that is very limited in lesser years, should we not be building more supply? I'll come back to that in the latest round.
See if you can answer that as a yes or no. Otherwise, we'll...
Building more hydro ability, yes.
Let me just dovetail onto that question. I think we've established quite conclusively through the testimony today that government policy seems to be obstructing the least expensive energy sources available to consumers while mandating the most expensive. I have more and more constituents complaining to me about absolutely out of control electricity bills. And as I said in my opening statement, the arrival of the family utility bill is now becoming a cause of increasing concern. What do we tell these folks? Are there skyrocketing electricity prices due to acts of God or acts of government?
I would tell you, and you can go look at the record, we are in the fifth year of 6 years of rate increases of 7.84% each. And the bulk of those increases are due to governmental mandates, be it state or federal.
So we've done it to ourselves. Mr. Coombs, do you agree?
I would just add that we're looking at a 4.5% rate increase this year.
Mr. Bladel?
Yeah, that's one of our biggest challenges, is how to afford some of the regulations that come down that we have to then implement.
It's been suggested that, well, hydropower isn't a reliable a form of electricity generation because we have droughts. And some years water doesn't come in like it does in other years. I always thought that's why we built dams. If the water was just going to run into the Pacific Ocean, it does that very well on its own, I've observed. And so the question occurs, particularly in light of testimony that this committee received just a few weeks ago, that through natural processes, the planet generates about 45,000 gallons of water per person per day. So the question occurs, is this a water shortage or is it a shortage of storage capacity?
May I take that, Mr. Chairman?
Sure.
In our case, it has mostly to do with a shortage of storage capacity. The projects, the 24 projects from We Get Power, do not have the large storage capacity that the projects out west do have.
And yet the radical left wants us to tear down our existing dams and hydroelectric facilities. We're fighting that battle right now on the Klamath. They have great designs to tear down the Snake River dams. I guess, Mr. Corwin, that's in your neck of the woods. What would be the source of replacement power for these dams?
The studies that have been done, it's about 1,100 average megawatts. By the way, a lot of power could power the entire city of Seattle. Studies show you'd have to replace it with another baseload type resource, which would be natural gas or coal.
Oh, but we're told, no, don't worry, we'll just have more solar and wind. How's that going to work?
You have to have something to firm the variable resources. So, and again, it needs to be a baseload resource.
Oh, that's right. So we have to keep those generators spinning. If it's going to be wind and solar, we're going to have to build additional generating capacity to back the wind and solar up, since we're tearing down the hydroelectric dams. Is that pretty much the situation?
Yeah, and hydro is a particularly good baseload resource and a very flexible one, and can back up those sources.
Legislation was introduced in the last session by, I believe, Mr. McDermott to authorize the removal of those dams. Are you in support or opposition to that proposal?
Absolute opposition.
We've talked a little bit about the salmon survival rates. What are they at these dams? Do you know?
Yeah, they're in the mid-90%, which is right on target, better than you see naturally through those portions of the river, 93 to 95%.
And how are the salmon runs doing these days?
They're doing well. They come and go for natural reasons, ocean conditions, et cetera, but they're right in there on
target. I was going to say, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which shifts cold water flows between Alaskan waters and Pacific Northwest waters on about a decadal cycle, is now favoring the Pacific Northwest again, is it not?
Yeah, for some portions.
And what a surprise, the salmon population is returning. Up until a few years ago, it was favoring Alaskan waters. Alaska was having record salmon runs, and the Pacific Northwest was hurting. Isn't that correct?
That's correct. And what we can measure is how they do through the hydropower system, and they do very well.
So all of the draconian restrictions that were proposed, in some cases imposed, on our water systems, were a solution in search of a problem. Thank you. My time's up, Mr. Politano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Bledow, you mentioned in your testimony that Western relies on appropriations from Congress or through advanced financing from your customers. If Congress does not appropriate the funds, and if the customers choose not to finance a specific project, what happens to the project?
In that case, if there's no financing, then that project would, or that particular project would not be completed. But what our experience is, the only time the customers would not fund it is if there was absolutely, we couldn't agree that it was needed, and it really didn't serve our need. There's a number of times with Western where we've kind of had a disagreement, and we end up working through it to get to a common solution that we support and they support.
Thank you. Mr. Corwin, could you comment on how Bonneville Power System is different from Western in its ability to access capital, and what is the role of the ratepayers in approving projects?
Yes, thank you, Ranking Member. Yeah, the two systems grew up quite differently. Obviously, Bonneville is a integrated system. It started as a unified system and statutorily remains so. So their capital is treated that way as well. When they need access or additional capital, they run a process with the customers in the region to try to identify the appropriate approach for that, and then come up with directions, because all of that debt service hits the customer's rates. Again, there's no free lunch here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. Combs, the facilities you mentioned are the Army Corps facilities, right?
That's correct, ma'am.
What is their primary authorized purpose?
It is generally going to be either flood control or navigation or there's a third purpose in there, but
primary though.
Yes,
flood,
ma'am.
Control.
Yes, ma'am.
So how is that different from storage? How does that differ? How does it affect it? How are we now saying they're supposed to be stored?
Our projects have two major pools, the conservation pool and the flood control pool. And as long as the level is in the conservation pool, the people that have the control of the storage have control of it. So our power pools within that conservation pool, Southwestern can schedule the power when they need it. When it gets up into the flood control pool, that's above the hydropower pool, then the Corps takes over the scheduling, because they have to make sure that they can evacuate enough space to allow for additional rainwater.
So how many times have you had to worry about the flood control turned over to the Army Corps?
Our problem has not been necessarily with the flood control. Our problem has been with the conservation pools getting too low when there are not enough inflows in periods of severe drought. We've had two of them over the past year.
What are your findings and the reason for the low water levels?
The reason for the low water levels is a lack of inflows, which primarily has been because of a lack of rain.
Maybe overuse in some areas?
The storage is all allocated and accounted for. And so water supply only gets a certain amount of that water, and they can't encroach upon the hydropower pool, nor can we impinge upon their use of their pool.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Corwin, you mentioned in your testimony that Columbia River Treaty is nearing the 10-year notice to renew. It's a 50-year compact, if I remember. And as you stated, negotiations will be primarily handled by the State Department. Why is it important the State Department recognize and consult with the region regarding treaty negotiations? And I've read your testimony, and I agree with you that there has to be some changes. And again, just with the prior witness, there have been changes. We have to adjust to those changes. Am I correct?
Yes, I appreciate the question. The State Department has a lot of issues on its plate, obviously. So for this one, going into a negotiation with Canada, which should, State Department will do their own analysis of what they think the treaty needs based on recommendations from the region starting next year, but it's really important for them to keep in touch with the region and to honor the input from region, especially from the customers that are on the hook for the power that goes to Canada right now, which is about 10 times the power that the United States sees out of this treaty. So
who's benefiting?
Yeah, so Canada, the BC government is benefiting right now, and the State Department really needs to stay in coordination with us as they go into that negotiation.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Mr. LaMalfa.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Oh, as I was alluding to in previous comments here, you know, we seem to be moving in a direction in this country that takes away fracturing, coal, stonewalling the pipeline, and adding taxes to petroleum products. And we see what we're challenged with hydro, with threats of dam removal like on the Klamath and the Snake, the inability to build new hydro supply, and then the shifting of water supply and the time of year where it's released. In California, there's proposals underway to release much more of the water in the spring from the CVP area, and we find that the effects of that are that it could cause, since most of the water be released in the spring, not during the time of year that could run through turbines during the peak use of summertime, that we could see rates go up perhaps 50% because most of the water is gone. You have to find alternative sources of electricity. So putting aside the use of that water for agriculture and human use and otherwise, we do know that the vast majority of salmon, for example, in the Sacramento River, they do their spawning in the late summer and the fall. But if we've reduced the vast majority of the water supply during the spring run, you know, Mr. Tippin, I'd like to hear what your thoughts might be on that, in that will there be the cold water now available in the stored water we have left over for those runs? What is the effect going to be when we want to talk salmon on available cold water during the time they need it in the late summer or fall if we adopt this type of thinking with releasing the vast majority during the spring?
Yeah, what you're referring to, of course, is what the State Department of Water is doing in terms of the delta flows, and they have a proposal on the table that would increase the flows in the spring time frame, so May and June, that what they call it is unimpaired flows, which that means if the Shasta Dam didn't exist, they want about 75% of the water to flow down the river during that time frame. The purpose stated is that it would help the delta in terms of salinity levels and other things and produce or protect the delta smelt. Problem with that, as you mentioned, is that that means that hydropower is not available when it's needed in the summer months, but it also has been estimated through modeling that we have worked with the coalition to perform that 50% of the time the Shasta Dam would be at what's called dead pool levels. That means that it can't get to the spillways. What that means is there's no cold water to go down the river. There's not enough water for the salmon, so we would have, you know, another endangered species that would be impacted by that. We also would experience perhaps costs by water utilities. The Redding Water Utility may have to relocate its intake station on the Sacramento River because of the low river flows. There's a myriad of issues that are with that, and I would encourage the subcommittee to pay attention to that and to weigh in on the need for a balanced approach. And make sure that they adhere to their co-equal goals, as they state.
Does it feel very co-equal right now?
At the moment,
or balanced?
I don't feel equal at the moment.
Certainly. Well, so I guess when we list all these things off, what we're finding is that much more of this is government cause instead of the ability to take advantage of what we know to be available, whether that's, you know, talking about climate change for a moment, if it exists, then yeah. If we don't have the facilities to capture what is now going to be an increased runoff during early spring, early summer, because you don't have that de facto storage system that a flow snowpack is, what steps should we be taking if that is occurring?
Well, if that occurs today, obviously, when we produce that energy, we're doing it with a thermal resource. I mean, that is what we have at our disposal to create that energy. That energy is going to produce greenhouse gas emissions and cost the ratepayers more money through the need to put in allowances for that pursuant to the California Cap and Trade Program.
Is the thermal resource embraced with open arms as much as solar and wind is?
Absolutely not.
Mm. Okay, I yield back, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Great, thank you. I want to thank all of our witnesses for their testimony today and for their patience. We may have additional questions that will be submitted in writing, and the committee record will be held open for 10 days. Of course, the written testimony that you submitted is already part of the record, and if there's no further business to come before the subcommittee stands adjourned.
Thank you.